It's a beautiful spring day on the East Cape of Baja at the Hotel Palmas de Cortez, and the participants of the 11th annual Roy Clark Billfish Tournament are gathering for 4 days of poolside relaxation and plenty of incredible big game fishing. Scoring for this tournament is based on the number of marlin or sailfish leadered and released, with bonus points and prizes available for Dorado, Tuna, and Wahoo. After 4 days of fishing, the two-person team with the most points takes home the trophies and the $2,000 first place check. But in a tournament like this, everyone experiencing the thrill of fishing the East Cape goes home a winner. This tournament always kicks off with a big dinner and a rundown of the rules by Roy Clark.
Everybody, get your attention a little bit. I want to thank everybody for coming to the 11th annual Roy Clark Billfish Tournament held here at Palmas de Cortez. There's a lot of marlin out there right now. They're pretty much everywhere. Dorado, tuna's not been too good, but I'll tell you, a lot of big Dorado came in today. So, should be a successful tournament. I just want to go over some rules with everybody first so everybody knows the guidelines.
Every day, each team will draw for a new boat to keep things fair. But really, there aren't any bad boats in the hat.
Marco. Hello.
That was good.
JB.
JB.
How many sodas?
None.
How many beers?
At least a dozen.
Unless you're that guy, I really wouldn't recommend drinking nothing but beer, as fighting billfish in the tropical sun can really test your endurance. In this tournament alone, nearly 60 billfish, mostly striped marlin, were leadered and released. This week, we're on the East Cape of Baja, California, sir, out of the Hotel Palmas de Cortez in the town of Los Barriles, fishing the 11th annual Roy Clark Billfish Tournament. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. The East Cape of Baja is known for being loaded with striped marlin, and on most days it's typical to see many free-jumping marlin, which can be chased down and casted to with success. But today, the first day of the tournament, is not one of those days. The marlin seem to be holding deep, so maybe a really big teaser is what we need.
If they're down there deep, it just makes enough of a bubble trail to bring them up and have them take a look at the rest of the lure.
Okay. Good luck.
We're with Carl Bratbold and Brian Style, two captains that spend their summers catching many metric tons of fish in the Bering Sea. They have confidence in their giant teaser, but after a few hours, the captain and deckhand suggested that they slow down and slow troll a ballyhoo rigged with a large egg sinker under the chin.
Ready for marlin.
And one piece of advice that everyone should take is to listen to your crew.
Take him on the line.
Later. Oh yeah.
Welcome back to the East Cape of Baja. I'm Justin Wolf. Carl Bratvold and Brian Stiles have created some luck by slow trolling deep on their first day of the four-day 11th annual Roy Clark Billfish Tournament. The leader has already been touched, so this striped marlin counts for points. But that's not the same thing as being landed and released.
There he goes.
Oh, yeah. Nice work, baby.
Oh, it's 40 pound line.
Yeah.
Yeah, 40 pound line.
The tournament rules, we have to stop fishing at 3, which gives everyone time to go for a swim before the next day's boats are drawn.
Okay, the top boat today, you guys, was the bill fighter was Brooke and Carolyn from Oregon. They get the prize for the top boat, get some Procure Basin. It works everywhere, you guys. Just stop.
Brooke and Carolyn Douglas from Portland, Oregon were top boat with 3 marlin, and now they've started off the next day right where they left off. A breeze has come up, which also seems to have brought up the fish as well.
Oh yeah.
Thank you, Captain.
Ready for another one.
Let's go get another one.
Okay.
Still, well before we're ready to eat lunch, another fish took a trolled ballyhoo. So now it's Carolyn's turn to add to the day's points total. Captain wants to back down on the fish and leader it as quickly as possible since it is a tournament and you want as much time as possible to try to catch another fish. But on the other hand, he doesn't want too green of a fish next to the boat, which can be difficult to release. So it's important to play the fish just right.
Very good.
Thank you.
Nice
fish. That was beautiful fish.
Ready for another one.
Go get another one, boys.
Before long, the third fish of the day is hooked up, which has Brooke and Carolyn in solid running for first place.
Number 3. Whoa!
Look at it go!
That's a great day of marlin fishing for Brooke and Carolyn. And the good thing for everyone is that there's still one more day of fishing ahead.
Awesome.
It's the final day of the 11th annual Roy Clark Billfish Tournament. And while everyone's out trying to earn more points, today we're heading out to try to catch some fish to serve for appetizers and with tonight's steak dinner. We're running north with Roy Clark towards a series of shark buoys that normally hold Dorado.
Yeah, we're fishing these shark buoys for Dorado. All the shark buoys collect the bait. That's where the Dorado normally are. There's about four or five shark buoys out here. We're about 25 miles out.
Today, the Dorado just don't seem to be home, and it looks like it's going to be just steak with our steak dinner. But out of the blue, our captain hears over the radio that there's porpoise.
Look at the porpoise today. Maybe we got a big tuna. Let's go.
What fishermen usually call spinner porpoise are actually a true dolphin and not a porpoise. But the important thing is that they have the intelligence to work cooperatively with tuna to catch bait fish. So where you have spinner dolphin, you usually have tuna. Spinner dolphin of all ages swim together in unison in large schools with an amazingly developed and complex social structure. Similar to a wolf pack, there are leaders and followers. And some scientists believe that the spinner dolphin's habit of jumping out of the water while spinning up to 7 revolutions is a way of communicating with others in the school. And it could certainly be a way to dislodge parasites. But whatever the reason for the behavior, it sure is fun to watch.
That was pretty cool. Spinning these things or something else, watch them spin like that.
Sometimes tuna will jump all over artificial lures, but not today. So the best move we can make is to go get some live bait.
Yeah, we can't get them with lures right now. These guys with bait, live bait, hook it up. So we're gonna go out to the Ocho Ocho at a shark buoy and get some bait. Come back and get them. Good job, buddy. Oh, right, the old tangaroonie. Now we're logging. Now we're gonna get some tuna. That's what I'm talking about.
Put bait for tuna.
Hook up. Light bait. Beautiful thing. Throw it out there. 2 seconds. Hooked up. That's what it's all about. Big tuna, too. It's a good one. Good tuna. We're sitting there trolling that lures for almost 45 minutes. We had one strike. Come out here with light bait. 2 minutes, you're hooked up. What a difference. Whew.
Pretty good. Pretty good bait.
Yeah, we're going to get this tuna land and we're going to take it back to the lodge and they sashimi it up for you right there. It's awesome. I'm going to feed it to everybody for the tournament. Tonight's awards night, so it'll be great. He don't like the boat. Yeah, baby. Good job. Oh, size of that baby. Right on. Good job, buddy. Ooh. Grande.
This is a nice one.
Yeah, really nice one. You're a good man. Great job. Tuna circle. Grande.
Yeah, a little bigger.
Yeah, a little bigger. Woo! Whoa, that one got the best of me there. I want to push it 80. Whew. I don't know what we're going to do with 100. Got them off?
Yeah.
Nice tuna there. Very nice one. 80 pounds.
Close, huh?
Yeah.
We have plenty of tuna now, in fact some extra, that we can have filleted and frozen or even smoked, which is really great. And all of that is handled back at Palmas de Cortez, where they also take your fish and serve up the best sashimi on this side of the Pacific. After the mid-afternoon appetizers, the awards are passed out. And this year, the $500 check for the biggest Dorado went to Jeff and Matthew Caswell.
Congratulations again.
Thank you.
You know what? Matthew, here's a $500 check.
For the biggest Dorado.
Jeff and Matt also took third place overall in the tournament for another $500. And second place honors went to Josh and Leroy Barrow.
Also, Accurate Reel sponsors the tournament. You get two reels from Accurate. They're a twin drag reel. They're the best twin drag reels made in USA. They are the best.
That's nice.
There you go. Oh yeah, they're awesome reels. Congratulations, you guys.
And first place went to Brooke and Carolyn Douglas.
They had seven marlin. They ran away with it the last day. There was a lot of marlin caught today. Today, there was 25 marlin caught in the tournament and four tuna. It was one of the better last days we've had. So that means you got to come back next year.
Yay.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Your certificate for first place is $2,000 this year.
Nice. Thank you.
Oh.
Congratulations to Brooke and Carolyn. And if you'd like to be part of next year's tournament, then call or email Roy Clark today. The Gulf of California, otherwise known as the Sea of Cortez, is just over 700 miles long and is thought to be one of the most diverse seas on the planet, with over 900 fish species. Fishermen are well acquainted with a few of those species, but those who snorkel or dive, especially on the East Cape, have a much better idea of what exactly lies below the surface. Mariana Padilla, a certified diving instructor who runs the activity center at the Hotel Palmas de Cortez, is taking a couple of clients out for a morning of snorkeling at a place called Punta Pescadero, just a few miles from the hotel. The coral reefs in this area attract experienced divers and snorkelers from around the world, but with a little help from Mariana, those with little or no experience will have no problem exploring the amazing beauty of this undersea world. At first, the quantity of life can be overwhelming, but as you become more used to this environment and your eyes begin to focus, you'll begin to see more clearly the incredible diversity and color of Baja's coral reefs. Another great thing to do while visiting the East Cape is to rent quad runners and explore the interior. The staff at Palmas de Cortez can help you with the details, and there's no shortage of interesting places to explore. One of my favorites is a canyon that includes waterfalls and ponds. There's a small lower pond, and hidden in the canyon above, a larger waterfall and pond that just seems to magically appear out of nowhere. In the smaller bottom pond, if you take a close look, you'll see that the dingy water is alive with fish that somehow not only survive, but thrive in this harsh tropical desert environment. It's spawning time, and just like a largemouth bass, this fish is guarding its nest from the hordes of potential raiders. Something else that might be unexpected is the incredible numbers of butterflies that fill the flowering bushes just after the rainy season in early fall. One might never expect to find all this colorful life, especially if you just looked at it from an airplane. So you just can't know unless you go. The town of Los Barriles is a quiet, safe place to enjoy all that the East Cape has to offer. Begin planning an adventure today by calling or visiting VanWormerResorts.com. Today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that this show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.